So this man, this pastor, he tried to tear me down. He talked about how I'm struggling and that he knows people that are more advanced than me, and decided to send the picture that he took of me without my consent. He sent it to me. And I guess that was his way of showing me that I'm ungodly, or that was his way of, I guess, letting me know that he has something on me. So naturally, I'm thinking that, oh, he's going to try to expose me, or he's going to try to put my photos out there that he took of me without my consent. I'm here to expose myself. I'm guilty. And I'm guilty of associating myself with someone who wants to tear me down, someone who wants to draw me away from God. And it's very clear who the ungodly one is. Now, it's one thing to make a mistake and own up to it. I'm here telling you my truth. My discernment was telling me that he's not who he portrays himself to be. That he's living a double life. And a lot of these pastors are. Because on one hand, they are preaching the gospel. They may even have a gift, and God gives gifts without repentance. So God could use these people even when they are walking in darkness, even when they may have wicked ways about them. Because he was offended because I told him that I desire someone who wants to draw me closer to God, doesn't negate the fact that we are human. However, he lives a double life. He is not who he says he is. I can stand in my truth. I can boldly say where I'm wrong at. The problem is, if you cannot admit to your wrong, and you cannot receive when someone is telling you that you're wrong, or someone is telling you their truth, that is a problem. That is where the problem is at. I am very disappointed in myself for allowing myself to believe something that is not true. It didn't go as far as he thought it was going to go, but it went far enough. It went far enough. And God is not pleased. And when I cried out to the Lord, he told me, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay." People think that because they're in a position of authority, or because they have a title, that they are untouchable, or they cannot walk in humility, they cannot receive reproof, that they are above reproach. The Bible says in order to enter into the kingdom of heaven, that you have to be childlike. Not childish, but childlike. What does it mean to be childlike? That means that you are willing to receive correction. That means you are understanding that you don't know everything. It doesn't matter how much Bible you know. It doesn't matter how many people you know. It doesn't matter how you are respected. It doesn't matter what title you have or what you have accomplished. God is going to judge us all, and he's going to bring back every moment, every encounter that we've had with people and how we treated them. And we have to look at ourselves. We have to be able to see where we are in error. I can admit my wrong. But if you're walking in pride and you think that nobody can tell you about yourself, you are blind to yourself. And the moment somebody tells you, "Hey, this is what I'm experiencing," and you get defensive, that is a spirit of pride. That is a spirit of pride. I'm here to tell you. That defensive part of you is that spirit manifesting itself. Even if you disagree with what somebody is saying, you should be able to listen and get understanding. The Bible says, in all you're getting, get understanding. You should be able to get understanding from the experience. If people are experiencing these things about you, that's the truth. That's their truth. And then you want to believe one way about yourself, but if everybody's experiencing something different, then chances are you are that thing. If it walks like a duck, quacks like a duck, then it's a duck. If other people are experiencing that you are prideful, then chances are that's what you are, whether you like it or not, whether you want to receive it or not. And you got to be able to be like a child, willing to learn, willing to receive correction, being okay with being wrong. That is walking in true humility. There are going to be a lot of pastors that don't inherit the kingdom of heaven. And they think because, oh, I casted out demons in your name, I prayed for this, I did all these pastoral duties. And they think that because of these works, that they're going to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Do you understand that partiality is even a sin? That means being partial, showing favoritism, respecting people who may have more money than others, and treating those who you feel is beneath you, treating them like they're nothing, tearing them down. That's also sinful. The worst sin are the sins of the spirit. And one of them are pride. I know that God is not pleased. God is not pleased. A lot of the people in the Bible, they were flawed individuals, right? But the ones that he used the most were the ones that was able to accept that they weren't perfect. Even Paul said, "Oh, wretched man am I." Even Paul, who we talk about, even Paul in the Bible, whose name was Saul, that God changed to Paul, people uphold him to a certain standard and they say that that's their favorite person in the Bible. But even him, he had enough humility to say, "Oh, wretched man am I." He was able to see himself. He was able to see the things that I want to do that is right, I don't do. And he even said that the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, is the only reason why we're able to follow the law of God. He understood, and God understood, that we were not able to just follow the law as it is in our own strength. We need the Holy Spirit to even follow the law. If this man was able to explain this, if this man was able to see that even he can't follow the law without the Holy Spirit, what makes anybody think that they're above reproach? What makes anybody think that they're above correction? It doesn't matter if you're a pastor. It doesn't matter how much scripture you know. How can you say that you're a man of God, yet you don't experience conviction, and then you go up there and you preach when you know you have done your brother or your sister wrong? The Bible says, "Love thy neighbor as thyself." That is a commandment as well. Somehow we forget that part of it too. We're supposed to love our neighbor as ourselves. How are we forgetting that? But guess what? Some people don't even love their self. So how can they love someone else? And this is the thing that people don't realize, is that while you're treating your brother or your sister in Christ, while you're treating your brother or your sister in Christ the wrong way, you have no clue what they're going through. People talk about winning souls. But if you can't even keep the souls that you have in a church, how can you talk about winning souls? Do you understand that the souls that are lost are not just because they are denying Christ, just because they don't know about Christ? It's because of their experience in the church. And people are sick of it. When I cried out to God, I took responsibility for my own actions. But then he also told me, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. Judgment is coming. Judgment is coming. Judgment is coming to the church first. The truth is, leaders and ministers are held to a higher standard because they are the face of the church. A couple days ago, my friend, my best friend, she called me and told me that her mother cried and told her, crying hysterically, that she had a dream and it was about me. I haven't talked to this woman in maybe a couple years. And the reason why I stopped talking to her, because she had a religious spirit. She has a religious spirit that is like unto witchcraft. And so she tells her that she has a dream, basically, that I got killed. Then she says, I wouldn't mind having Azzy, my daughter. We'll take good care of her, basically. How demonic is that? So in the name of Jesus, I rebuke and I bind every word curse that has been spoken over me or that has been spoken over your people in the name of Jesus. And I ask, dear God, that you reverse every curse, every hex, every spell, every witch, every warlock that shall rise against your true people, the real ones. I ask that you would avenge us in the name of Jesus, as in your word, God. God is not pleased. There are so many people, so many religious people in the church. They are coming in the name of the Lord. They're coming in the name of Jesus. But they're really workers of iniquity that the Bible is talking about. That is who God is talking about, that he will say, depart from me, I never knew you, you workers of iniquity. So I asked God, I said, God, how could you not know someone if you know everything, if you're all-knowing, if you're omniscient, if you're omnipresent? How is that possible? And I believe that he told me it's because he doesn't know sin. He only knows himself. If you don't have the Spirit of God in you, he doesn't know you. We are made in his likeness and in his image. And there's no good thing that dwells within us unless we have the Spirit of God. The body is the Lord's temple. If he does not live inside of us, we're out of his hedge of protection, and then he does not know us. He is good. Without him in us, without him inhabiting us, there's no good thing in us. I was on the highway when I was told this information. I went through a series of emotions. I went through fear. I went through anger. I went through sadness. But then God gave me peace. And it was the peace that passes all understanding. And so I thank God that he is not like man. I thank God that he is who he says he is. He is not a man that he shall lie. He is who he says he is. He says, I am that I am. And his word is true. Jesus Christ is soon to return. God is judging the church first. The fire is being turned up on the earth. You either going to be on fire for God, or you're going to walk in hellfire. And that is the truth. It's not God's will for man to perish, but look at the wickedness. Look at the wickedness that's in people's hearts. If you're not operating under the Spirit of God, then you're operating under the spirit of the Antichrist. The Bible says the spirit of the Antichrist is already amongst us. Which spirit are you operating under? If you're not in him, then you're in darkness. If you're not in light, you're in darkness. There's no more lukewarmness. There's no more gray areas. There's no more middle ground. God is doing away with that. He's separating the wheat from the tares. He's separating his people. He says that if you are lukewarm, he will spit you out of his mouth. He will prefer you to either be hot or cold. That's what the Bible says. There's a difference between you being a righteous man falling versus you being a worker of iniquity. People, I realize, in a church are not who they say they are. You're not who they say they are. Doesn't mean you don't fail. A righteous man falls 7 times and rises, but the wicked is overthrown by calamity. There's a lot of people in the church that are operating in witchcraft. There's a lot of people within the church that has a strong delusion. There's a lot of people, on one hand, are constantly saying the spirit is leading them to do this. The spirit is telling them this. The spirit is telling them to go get ice cream. The spirit is telling them to do this and do that. The spirit is telling them that this person is their kingdom spouse. God is not a man that he shall lie. God is the God of order and decency. The thing about prophecy, it's conditional, is based off of your obedience. Not your sacrifice, but your obedience, because obedience is better than sacrifice. Not only is it conditional, but the Bible says that if a prophecy is true, the way you know is by it coming to pass. And if it hasn't come to pass and it's been 20, 30 years, then maybe, you missed something. God can do anything. I truly believe that. There's times when we join together in holy matrimony with the wrong person, and God did not authorize the marriage. Because it talks about in the Bible, what God has joined together, let no man put asunder. But if God did not join it together and it's unauthorized by God, then naturally that doesn't apply. If we're walking in our flesh and we're doing things based off of being governed by our flesh and our desires and trying to project that this is God, or this is my kingdom spouse, or God is telling me things. You can manifest things based off of your strong desire and strong delusion. A lot of this is going on in a church. I do not believe that this is what God intended church to be. We are the church. So if we're out of order, or if the head is out of order, then everything is out of order. That's not going to win souls. You got to be able to keep the souls that's in there. If people's experience of you plays a role in them being at the church, if you have a nasty attitude, if you are so high in the spirit that you know earthly good, if you are walking in so much pride and nobody can tell you about yourself, that's going to cause people to draw away from the church. Don't you understand? If we are the church, you play a role in why people are there. You play a role why souls are being lost. Going back to this whole kingdom spouse thing, because I digress. This is a major issue in the church. This is a major issue. People may have just a simple crush or simple admiration for someone, and they assume that, oh, they're my kingdom spouse, or the Lord is telling me this, or the Lord and the Lord and the Lord and the Lord. Maybe you just have a human crush on somebody. Why are we over spiritualizing natural human experiences? This is a problem too. It's extreme. And yet there's no Bible to back up what is being said or how people are moving. The problem with experiences is that people can solely go based off their experiences and not read one bit of scripture to compare and contrast or to confirm whether or not this is even biblical. Everything that you're experiencing, it still has to line up with the word in the law of God. God is not going to go against his law. Now, there are things that can be misinterpreted. There are things that can be misconstrued. Like, for example, where it says, putting away. The Bible talks about God hates divorce. And it talks about, you know, if a man puts away his wife or whatever, that he'll be committing adultery and all this stuff like that. But understand that putting away means basically separation. And it talks about you have to have a certificate of divorcement, because back then they didn't have the same court system that we have now. People can take the Bible out of context too. But it's important to study to show yourself approved. So you have the people who are overly spiritualizing things, that the Spirit of the Lord said this, the Spirit of the Lord is doing that, the Spirit of the Lord, it's just too much. At what point in all of that are you studying to show yourself approved? Are you studying to find out, are you actually hearing the true and living God? His word is true, and his word is the living word. So you got that, on one hand, the whole over-spiritualizing and, oh, the spirit, that is like spooking people and you know, making people not want to go to church. Then on the other hand, you have the people who are extremely, what does the Bible say? The reason why I'm saying all of this is because I am so over the church. This is me exposing myself and exposing my truth. I'm so over it. And I truly believe God is not pleased. It's become so theatrical, so messy. So, like I was saying, because I digress again. You have, on the other hand, people who are so extremely Bible, and there's no Holy Spirit. I partook in a Bible study. And going back to what I was saying about the putting away, what the Bible says about that, this woman decided to do a Bible study about why she felt like I couldn't get remarried. She was explaining to me, what does the Bible say? The Bible says this. The Bible says that. But the Bible also says that his grace is sufficient. I truly believe that God has forgiven me, just like he's forgiven other things that I've done and that everyone has done, you know, when you repent. And so I have repented for my sins. And I believe that God will eventually make that happen for me. But she was trying to tell me why I can't be remarried based off of the Bible. And so she's like, but what does the Bible say? What does the Bible say? Mind you, this woman has done so many things that I've never even thought to do. Robbed, cheated, you know, was in homosexuality, all these things. But then, because she's turned her life around, she felt good to tell someone, what does the Bible say? The Bible says you can't get remarried. And in fact, when I did my research and I've done study and I've also listened to other people's studies, putting away meant separation. That's when you're committing adultery, because you haven't been legally separated. There wasn't a certificate of divorcement, and that's what the Bible was talking about. People don't understand that. That's how it should be interpreted, because putting away is separate from divorce. But it led me to learn and study more. So you have people that's like, what does the Bible say? And they're so rigid in their approach. Even God is not rigid. Otherwise, we wouldn't have Saul, whose name was changed to Paul, or all these people in the Bible who were flawed individuals who God has transformed their life. That is the story of grace. So what makes a person think, just because they're in one place in their life, that they can rise up in pride and say, the Bible says this and the Bible says that? The Bible is the word of God. God can give you a word, a rhema word. That means directly from heaven, a now word. That is also God's word. The Bible scriptures are basically a point of reference. It's people's experiences and encounters with God. And it can be misinterpreted. It can be misrepresented. And people feel like just because they've learn so much, like this particular woman, oh, I've read the Bible 11 times. Don't you understand that you are the same person that the Bible is speaking against? The stiff neck, the proud. God even hates a proud look. The Bible is talking about people like that, the religious crowd, the people who are constantly rising in pride and feeling like, well, I did this, I have this, or I am pastor so-and-so, or I am bishop so-and-so, I am prophetess so-and-so, I'm prophet so-and-so. God is not pleased with you because you're walking in pride. And that's worse than any other sin, because guess why? He can't do nothing with a person that's proud. Because guess why? You cannot see yourself. And he's going to judge the church first. And he's going to start with all these prideful people who are thinking that they're above somebody. Don't you understand that that's why souls are lost? How can you say that you have a desire to win souls if you don't even know how to treat the souls that's in the church? This is why there's lost souls. This is why I walked out of church. Because of the pride. And God knows that I'm sick of it. We should all be able to see ourselves. Just because you do deliverance doesn't mean that you don't need deliverance. Half the times, a lot of people who are doing deliverance and doing all this praying are the ones that need to be at the altar too. Just because you praying at the altar for people does not mean that you don't need to be getting at that altar in repentance. We should always be in repentance, because there are sins that we commit unknowingly because we're in a falling world. God is not pleased. Judgment is coming. Something is coming. Something is coming. You better be careful how you treat people. Doesn't mean that we won't make a mistake, but guess what? You better be careful how you treat people. Still, you can make it right. And if you don't choose to make it right, God is going to hold that against you. Even if wrong was done to you, you still got to make it right by forgiving the person who has done wrong to you. That is how God shows himself. He shows himself through people and our ability to walk in humility when we should be proud or we should be like the world. That is how he shows himself. That is his spirit. When we can forgive the unforgivable, when we can love the unlovable, when we can love our neighbor as unto ourselves, that is the spirit of God. When he can move on you to do something kind. That's why it's important to let the Holy Spirit inhabit your body, because we are half spirit and half flesh. Which part of you are you strengthening? You can weaken the spirit man by feeding yourself poison. That means not protecting your ear gate, not protecting your eye gate, by having and engaging in conversations that are very gossiping, that grieves the Holy Spirit. When you talk about your brother, when you talk about your sister, that grieves the Holy Spirit. And then sometimes I find myself getting sucked into it because people might want to share their experience. of what's going on, but we have to be led about even what we share. We should not be talking about each other like that. We should be talking to God about it. We should take it before God, and we should be careful about the things that we say. Every word that we speak, God is going to judge us for it too. Even if you feel like somebody has done you wrong, even if you felt like I have done you wrong, for those of you who do know me or has been in my life at some point, even if you feel like I've done you wrong, there's no excuse to respond in a way that is gossip. There's no excuse to respond in a way that is demeaning or degrading or down talking or attacking. We shouldn't fight our brother, our sister in Christ, even our lover, whoever. We shouldn't fight each other. Just because somebody does something doesn't mean we have to get on their level and do what they did and try to compete and do it even greater. We shouldn't do that. We have to be held accountable for our own actions. Everything doesn't require a response. Everything doesn't require a reaction. When you walk in the Spirit, the Holy Spirit reveals yourself to you. He's not going to spend too much time saying, oh, that person, yeah, this person, they need this and that. No, he's going to check us. I'm too busy trying to figure out my own life. I'm too busy trying to make sure I get myself right with God. I'm not here to point fingers at anybody. I am only sharing what I'm experiencing and exposing my truth. And in return, my desire is to help someone. But sometimes you have to be careful. If you're listening to someone because you're fishing for information, so you can say, oh yeah, girl, this is what I heard, or this is what she said, or this and that. That is so demonic. If you're listening to someone or you're watching someone's channel to judge the person, to say, oh, see, yeah, she has a this spirit, she has a rejection spirit, she has an abandonment spirit, you got a problem. You got to be able to rightfully divide the truth, and you got to be able to listen to the spirit of what's being said and actually listen to what's being said. Maybe you can learn something. It's not always about the other person. Maybe you can learn something. It's probably not about the other person all the time. Everything that I'm saying is based off of all the experience that I had in the church. And it's so much to the point where it's enough for me to walk away. But guess what? I'm not walking away from God. And I'm not trying to deceive myself either. I just know that God is not pleased. God is not pleased. And that there needs to be a reestablishment of the church. But guess where it starts? In us as individuals. Because we are the church. You are the church. How is other people's experience of you? The experience that one individual is having with you can be why their soul is lost or their soul is won. And God is going to judge us all for how we treat one another. I don't understand how people is trying to get people in their church when they don't even know how to treat people. How? When your brother or your sister is trying to tell you, hey, this is my experience. This is what I'm experiencing with you. And you can't receive it. Boom, that might be a lost soul. Did you ever think about it that way? People are disgusted by the church. Disgusted. I've experienced people in the world treating me better than people in the church. And you think somebody's gonna go to your church? You think somebody's going to be want to be a congregant? You think somebody's going to want to be a follower? When you don't even know how to treat your brother or your sister, you quick to hang up the phone on them, or you quick to gossip about them, or you quick to say, oh, that's their problem, or they have rejection wounds, or they have abandonment issues, it's them. No, it's you. We all have to check ourselves. And we all have to make sure that we're in right standing with God, and that we're loving our neighbor as unto ourselves. As the way we love ourselves, we should be loving our neighbor. You need the love of God in order to love yourself, so that you can pour out love to someone else. The problem is, the people in the church are not who they say they are. In the moment you try to tell them about themselves, or say, hey, this is my experience of you, they're not willing to take heed. It's unfortunate. Even the world has a system, like, for example, customer service, right? I've worked in customer service. Even when a person's acting crazy, how is it that the world has a system that is more understanding of, like, the Bible principles? I'm specifically speaking of customer service, right? The system is supposed to be the customer is always right. That means you want them to come back. You want them to have a pleasant experience. So even if they're acting crazy and they're having a bad day, you still treat them kindly. The Bible says when you be kind to someone that is basically being evil to you, it's like heaping coals of fire on their head. The customer is always right. You're still supposed to treat them with kindness, because you want them to come back, and you want them to have an experience that they can take away, even if they never come back, that this experience at this place was still a good experience, regardless of how they're perceiving it at the moment. That's how the church should be. That's how the church should think. But the church, there's so much pride, because I'm pastor so-and-so, I'm prophet so-and-so. I can't be wrong, I can't be in error. Nobody could tell me about me. That's dangerous, because guess what? Pride comes before the fall. And I know that judgment is coming. Judgment is coming, and you want to make sure that you do right by the people. You want to make sure that you're not losing souls. You got to be able to keep the souls that's already in the church.